It's a little surreal, honestly, getting up and doing this right now. So I first of all, appreciate your prayers. I just said to my table, I said, I'd really love your prayers when I get up here if this didn't stink. And I didn't use the word stink. You can ask them later, but and others offered to hold up my arms. I was grateful, appreciate for that. But we are all in this thing together, and you know, it's one of the interesting things. I've been a pastor for 37 years, and it's a challenge. I pastor a congregation of about 80 members. I pastor a congregation of about 300 members. Memorial Park, where I was the last 15 years, about 1,500 members. And getting an entire congregation to pull in one direction is really hard, you know, because we are protestants, and independent American protestants at that. It's been one of the real interesting discoveries in being your stated clerk in the last 2.5 years is trying to get all of us to pull together in the same direction, knowing that it's got to be contextualized, right? The way you do ministry in the Southeast is very different than the way you do it in the Northeast or the West Coast versus the Plains. I mean, it's got to be contextualized. And as I travel around every presbytery, each one's got a different flavor, different culture, different strengths, different things that really kind of mark it out. And yet, how do we all kind of go after the same thing given our unique contexts and gifts and callings? And Michelle, I don't have the gift that you have to pursue after the, you know, the families with disabilities and those who are disadvantaged, but you bring such passion to that. How do we find space for her to excel and for our congregations to embrace that so that we care for the most vulnerable among us? And I could do that. I could just go around the room and pick out person after person after person and do that same kind of thing, right? And it was about a year and a half ago, we invited Todd Bolsinger in to speak to a group of our executive pastors. He wrote the book Canoeing the Mountains. If any of you have heard about that, you would think that that was written like after the pandemic, but it was written before the pandemic. But it's all about what is now being described as adaptive leadership. That is to say, when Lewis and Clark set out, they were chosen as water explorers. And when they ran out of water and they hit the Rockies, I mean, imagine, you guys have seen them out the window. Like, imagine you're trained water expedition people and you come up upon those. Like, now what do you do, right? So anyway, Todd came to the office of the General Assembly and he walked into the office and because from our office, you can actually see launches from Cape Canaveral. So I brought him up to see a launch and he walked into our big kind of conference boardroom and the four gospel priorities up on the wall. And he walked into the office and he kind of looked up and he went, huh, I bet you have silos and those four things are competing for resources. And I said, okay, how did you do that in like 30 seconds? That's pretty impressive, you know? And he said, well, it's because an organization can only do one thing. And it looks like you're trying to do four things. And I'm a Haddon Robinson disciple. So immediately I heard Haddon inside my head saying, Dean, what's the big idea? And it took me a little while. But I found what our big idea is. And see, the better part of visionary leadership is not going through some cool process and coming up with some cool plan. And it's discerning what the Lord is already up to. Right? And I realized what God had called us to do was actually what was in our mission statement. You heard Bob Stauffer talking about it during his presentation. It's actually all over our book of government. The number one purpose of the session of a local church, to make sure evangelism happens, carrying out the Great Commission. Number one purpose of presbytery, to make sure the churches are carrying out the Great Commission. Number one purpose of the General Assembly is to make sure presbyteries are making sure churches are helping carry out the Great Commission, because the local churches, as the U.S. Marines say, the point of the spear. It's where the kingdom breaks in. And we're supposed to be doing everything we can to join in going after the Great Commission. I wasn't in the office as a stated clerk for more than 2 weeks, and somebody called me and said, so are we going to change the name of the denomination? And I said, you want me to be the shortest-lived stated clerk in the history of the EPC, right? And I got where they were coming from, right? Because the word evangelical has taken on a lot of social baggage, and I get that. I totally, totally get that. But I said, you know, I'm tired of other people defining who we are. Evangelical is a Bible word. It's our word. I want it back. I want it back from the politics. I want it back from the rancor. I want it back because it's about the good news of Jesus. And so that, if you've been to any Presbyterian meeting, you've heard me talk about putting the E back in the EPC. And by that, I meant evangelism. And we have doubled down on that. And you're going to hear the results of that in just a few minutes. Anyway, I think God has placed the vision for the EPC right in front of it. It's in our mission statement, it's in our vision statement, it's in our book of government. Nothing I am going to say in the next 20 to 30 minutes is actually new. As Bob Stoffer says to me, and you got to know, Bob is as old as dirt, okay? Bob is, he was ordained at the first ever EPC General Assembly. We didn't even have presbyteries yet when he was ordained. And he had to get ordained in front of like Andy Jumper and Ed Davis and like all of those guys. So I nothing but love and respect. But the bottom line is it's sort of back to the future. It's kind of back to who God made us to be. So nothing I'm going to say in the next 20 or 30 minutes is really new. In fact, if you've been paying attention all week, you will have heard it in Tom Ricks and Mike Moses. I was taking notes. I was like, Mike, man, you're stealing my thunder. You're stealing my thunder for Thursday night. You heard it when Shelley started us off in preaching, this big picture of our calling to enter in and be, you know, those folks who work with God and bringing about his creation. I heard it, Mike, in your sermon so much. You're going to hear echoes of that. I wrote this before I heard your sermon, but it's all in there, man. It's all in there. Same thing with Aaron. Same thing with Mark. In fact, I could step down right now and replay the last third of Mark Farrell's sermon, and they're very, very close. But same thing with Rosemary's summary, and I haven't heard yet what Kurt's going to preach tonight, but I know God's placed that on his heart. So there's not a lot of new stuff here, folks. So let me get through this. I'm not a real PowerPoint slide deck kind of guy, but let's go ahead and put those up on the screen if we could. Is there a way for me to see it in the back as well or no? No? All right, so I'm going to have to do this. All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to do some reflections, not only looking backward a little bit, but we're going to pivot now and kind of begin to look forward a little bit. This is the first General Assembly where, in leadership, you would call it organizational alignment, where we sought to take our national meeting and align it with our strategic, now we call gospel priorities. So you would have seen a new format in this General Assembly, trying to make sure that while the business of the church is being attended to, and was kind of like the meat of the sandwich throughout, we started with worship, ended with worship, and we were heavy on equipping, heavy on those gospel priorities and aligning not only the General Assembly around those gospel priorities. I've been super encouraged as I've traveled to presbyteries to find our presbyteries now aligning around those gospel priorities. And what I want to see in the years to come is our congregations aligning around those gospel priorities. Because here's the thing, when Haddon said in my head, what's the big idea? What I realized is the big idea of the EPC is our mission statement. We exist to carry out the Great Commission. Full stop. That's the big idea. And those four things, church planning, global movement, church health, effective biblical leadership, those are 4 points of one Great Commission sermon. They explain, prove, and apply that one big idea that we exist to carry out the Great Commission. They're just 4 ways of doing it. And I hope this week you kind of caught the gist of the fact that how those four are actually related and interrelated, and how they're beginning to collaborate and cooperate and work together. I think that was part of the design of missional and organizational alignment for this General Assembly. Okay, so let's talk about vision a little bit. Vision. Begin by looking at a couple of definitions, a little static, but the faculty or state of being able to see, that seems plain on its face. What about better, the ability to think about or plan the future with imagination and wisdom? and I'd like to emphasize wisdom. And not our own wisdom, not our cleverness, but wisdom that is from above, that God has given to us as wisdom. Better is a definition, or what we see is the way in which vision works in Proverbs 29 and verse 18. Where there is no vision, the ESV says, people cast off restraint. Where there is no vision, the King James says, people perish. Both have in common this idea where there's no vision. The one is people casting off restraint. The image is that of a bunch of oxen who've thrown off the yoke, and now instead of plowing the field as they are intended to, they're meandering all over the field, and not only are unproductive, but to the point that they, to their own peril, wander off the cliff because the yoke restrained them and gave them direction and purpose and meaning. And so the King James says they perish. And if God isn't in this, and if God isn't revealing to us, and if God isn't leading us, then we're just another denomination doomed to go down the steady and seemingly almost inevitable decline of the institutional church in the West in our time period. When we are not following God's vision, our future not guided by God's word, then we wander aimlessly, unproductively, and ultimately, we perish. One of the leadership axioms that I have ascribed to the moderator of the General Assembly before me, my friend over here, Scott, has reminded me from Max Dupree's, is the number one job of a leader is to define reality. And I would tell you, preachers, that's what you do on a Sunday morning and a Saturday night when you stand up and you exposit from this book. You are looking at a world that has a distorted understanding of reality, and you're reorienting them to what reality actually is. People have exchanged the truth for a lie, and they think the distortion is real. But the Word of God reveals to us what is real because God has determined what is really real. So our job is to define reality as God's preferred future for us, and it should be anchored in His Word. And in 37 years of doing pastoral ministry, one of the axioms that I have lived by, and I've told younger pastors, is this. It is way better to observe what God is doing and to go where He is moving and join Him in His activity than to make our own plans, however strategic they might be. If you can observe what God is doing and go and participate in that activity, that is frequently where you will catch what God's vision is. So we don't need to look something up. We don't need to come up with something new. The EPC, we already have that alignment and the purposes revealed in His Word. So let's look briefly again, just as a reminder, because you know vision leaks, we need to go back again and again and again. Let's look at the EPC's mission and vision. Let's put it up. Would you say this with me out loud? The EPC exists to carry out the Great Commission of Jesus as a denomination of Presbyterian, Reformed, Evangelical, and missional congregations. Scott taught me at the National Leadership Team, we would recite that at our meetings, to the beginning of every meeting, as a reminder to stay on mission focus. And I hope you've heard that a few times this week. And I hope if I showed up at your church and said, what's the mission of the EPC? You might be able to at least say, to carry out the Great Commission. Notice that the actionable part of this mission statement is thoroughly anchored in Scripture. It's anchored in Matthew 28, 16 through 20. The words of Jesus Himself are the core to our mission, and we're called to look ever outward to those who do not yet know the Savior. For we are a Great Commission family of churches. Henceforth, I am going to stop referring to the EPC as a denomination. I said that when I was leaving the sanctuary today, and someone came up to me and said, I think that's exactly right. So with the testimony of witnesses, I'm just going to go with it. It's actually there. I think we're a family of churches. I think that's who we are. But we're not just any family of churches. We're a family of churches. We are a Great Commission family of churches. Take a look at the EPC's vision statement. Let's read this together. To the glory of God, the EPC family aspires to embody and proclaim Jesus' love as a global movement. Say movement. Of congregations engaged together in God's mission through transformation, multiplication, and effective biblical leadership. Our four gospel priorities are firmly embedded in this vision that the Lord has given to us. They are not four distinct objectives, but are four defined, interrelated ways in which we carry out the Great Commission. Each one is related to and is essential to the other. You cannot have one without having the other. And together, we have a biblical approach to how it is that we would carry out the Great Commission, which is our mission. So for the sake of brevity and focus tonight, allow me to focus on two of the priorities and demonstrate how they're related to the others, grounded in Scripture and evident in the way the Lord is advancing his kingdom today. Say with me, movement. I remember at the Cedar Springs Assembly when we put this forward, and there were people who said, what in the world does that mean? That we're a global movement. We see movement in the book of Acts as the church grows and expands. I want you to think back on Mike's sermon on Tuesday night. From Jerusalem to Judea to Samaria, as you taught us, Mike, in Acts chapter 8, pretty much from Samaria to the ends of the earth, right there in one fell swoop, right? But it's not just our being sent out. It is that. But notice it starts in Acts chapter 2 with the nations coming to our doorstep at Pentecost. And to quote C.S. Lewis, Aslan is on the move. If you want to track the movement of God, track the movement of peoples, particularly displaced peoples, and you will see God working across the planet. Movements of people going out and coming in and breathing out, drawing near to be with Jesus, sent out to be like Jesus. Even today, we see the mass migration of people movements across the globe and in our own backyards. People are being sent out while others are being sent to us. Massive movements from displaced Syrian refugees into Lebanon to Afghan peoples coming to the D.C. and Bay Area to our very doorsteps. Once again, it is the movement of God in our Jerusalem, in other Judeas and Samarias, and yes, still to the ends of the earth, to some of the hardest places. So here's my summary. I want to remind you again of Jesus' great commission to his disciples. We could put up that slide. Let's read this together.
Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, for behold, I am with you to the end.
I know this isn't going to sound like rocket science, but in preparing this talk and reading that yet again for the millionth time, here's the light bulb that went on. This is actually Jesus telling his disciples to go and make disciples. Disciples making disciples. Do you get that? All right, hang in there with me for a little bit longer. All right, let me summarize my thoughts up to this point. It's in this next slide. Here's what I think. I think the EPC is called to be a multiplication movement of healthy congregations who make disciples who are sent into the world to make disciples. There's my summary statement. You want a picture of something, take a picture of that. I'm going to say it again. The EPC is called to be a multiplication movement. Can the world outreach people say amen? Multiplication, can the church planting people say amen? Woo! of healthy congregations. Can the church health people say amen?
Amen.
Who were sent into the world to make disciples. Can the EBL people say amen?
Amen.
That was kind of pathetic. The EPC is called to be a movement of healthy congregations of disciples who make disciples, sending them into all the world. So we're going to talk a little bit about what missiologists call a disciple-making movement, or DMs, or DMMs, as some call them. Remember, our mission is anchored in Scripture, Matthew 28, 16 through 20, to be specific. And there's not sufficient time tonight to unpack that text, and most of you are pretty familiar with it anyway, so let me just hit a couple of the high points. First, Jesus tells us to go. Say go. You've already heard from Mike Kuhn earlier this week the sent nature of our mission. Nobody get all freaked out on him because he'd said apostolate. He meant small a, small a. It is the DNA of being a disciple of Jesus that we are the sent ones. And as I read Matthew 28, that is not limited to a few people. He calls all who would be his disciples to go out and make disciples. It is in our DNA. We're all sent ones. And it happens every week, and you don't even know it. You gather on Sunday morning to be with Jesus, and then you leave. I love that phrase from Pastor Mark. What was that? The doors of amnesia. We're gathered to be with Jesus, sit at his feet, listen to his word, and then we're sent to be like Jesus. That's what he did. He said to a bunch of people, hey, come follow me. I'm going to make you guys fishers of men. And most of it was just walking down the road. They're on the way. Master, John's disciples fast and the other guys fast. We don't fast. Why don't we fast? A lot of his teaching was on the road. It was on the way. It was during life. As I was preparing this, I had this epiphany. I realized I started out in ministry as a campus minister. And when I first started in campus ministry, I had 4 students. And inside the first year, we had a fellowship of 150, okay? But after that first year, it never grew beyond 150. And here's why I think why. In the first beginning of that time, and I wasn't smart enough to know any better, I would just say to a bunch of college students, hey, I'm going to go shopping. Who wants to go to the store? And like 20 college students would pile into my Buick. You know, it's like a clown car thing. I mean, everywhere I went, hey, I've got to go and do this. Who wants to go with me? Yeah, I'll go with you. We went everywhere together. We did everything together. We did life together. And while we were jammed into the Buick going off someplace, someone would say, I don't understand free will and predestination. And it was like, okay, let's talk about it. Like, theology happened on the way, living life together. And we grew really rapidly. And then we got to be about 150 people, and this really interesting thing happened. People started saying, well, we want to have Bible study now. I love Bible study. Bible study is great. We want to have leadership training now, and we want to kind of have fellowship gatherings now. And it began to turn inward, and they began to become oriented toward themselves, and that outward-facing thing started to lose its edge. And that is the way our fallenness comes into community. We need one another. We need to gather together and to be at the feet of Jesus. But for what purpose? Jesus tells us what our purpose is. He gathers us to be with him so that he can send us to be like him in those places. That's kind of what disciples do. The second, our going is connected to making disciples. That's what Jesus did. He trained his disciples to do what he did, to follow where he went, and he commissioned them to do that. Yes, we go because we are sent ones, specifically and purposefully sent to make disciples. He calls us and equips us to be fishers of men. Finally, the Great Commission reminds us that the task of going and making disciples is to all the nations. The Greek ta ethne here, of course, more closely translates to people groups, not geopolitical boundaries. And while we tend to focus on political entities and identities, Scripture focuses on people groups, people on the move to and for God's greater kingdom purposes. And as I mentioned earlier, these peoples on the move have done so biblically, whether it's coming out of Egypt, they've done so historically, and they are presently moving at a phenomenal rate. Revelation 7 makes it clear the kingdom is comprised of every tribe, every nation, every people, every language, all before the throne of the Lamb. God has revealed his teleos, the end game, and his Spirit moves toward that greater kingdom come and earth on earth be done, kingdom in heaven. But my friends, there are obstacles. Before we get to the opportunities, we need to address some of the obstacles. With all of the biblical evidence before us and Jesus' own compelling commission, we tend to still disobey. The gravity of our fallenness in community is to turn inward instead of outward, and we fail to remember that while we are called to be with him, come to me, all of you who are weary and heavy laden, it's so that we can be sent to be like him as fishers of men. And for this reason, let me give you just three practical things that I think are obstacles to our doing this. The first is past practice. By past practice, if we reflect briefly on the history of the church, for the first 100, 300 years before the Edict of Milan or Constantine's edict that caused Christianity to be the official religion of the Roman Empire in 323, until that time, we were a countercultural underground movement. In fact, we were called the people of the way. The church multiplied rapidly. Say multiplied. It multiplied rapidly during that time, like everybody was getting into the Apostle Paul's Buick. The church multiplied during this movement phase of the church. And my friends, the same is true today in the Global South. People are on the move. We talked about the house church movement as there was incredible migration, particularly in China and India, from the rural communities to the urban communities. And the amazing thing is, as those people were on the move, so was the Holy Spirit. Today, this cross-cultural, counter-cultural, largely underground movement of God's people is in sub-Saharan Africa, India, China, and the South Pacific. They are all expressions of this church as movement. It was the institutionalization of the church. And this is an odd thing to say for a guy who runs a denomination. But it was the institutionalization of the church from 323 AD to today, where being a Christian was closely associated with what it meant to be a citizen of that country, has been at the expense of a biblical, lest I say, Mike, apostolic, small a, church. In other words, it came at the expense of being a disciple-making movement. And I think oftentimes the institution fights what has been biblically and historically and even presently observably the way in which God calls his disciples to make disciples who make disciples. And I'm not proposing to get rid of institutions. We need them desperately. But we also need them to adapt and conform to the biblical picture and the expression of what God is doing in the world today, and go join him in that activity. Here's the second obstacle. This one's kind of interesting. It's the question of paradigm. The second obstacle to our being a biblical movement of disciples who make disciples, is one of paradigm. Due to years, even generations, even centuries, of certain perceptions of church or Christian, we have a paradigm problem. And we may need to see what it means to be church or what it means to be Christian differently than the way we have become accustomed. That is to say, more as the original artist intended or revealed in his greatest work of all time, the Scriptures. So allow me to demonstrate the issue with problem. For a moment, please consider this sketch from the artist William Ely Hills. Have you ever seen this before? It's an interesting sketch. It's a famous sketch of two women, of Hill's wife and his mother-in-law are both to be found there. Look a little closer. Just a sign of hands. How many of you see the old woman? Hands down. How many of you see the young woman? Fascinating. For the longest time, I could only see the older woman, Hill's mother-in-law. It took me forever to see his wife. I know that she's there. I can see her. But honestly, each time I look at that picture, my default is to see the older woman. I have to work to see something else, even though it's been there all along. I have to retrain my brain to see something that's been there all along. This is called cognitive confirmation bias. Your brain gets printed with an image, and it is very difficult to see something different than that image once it's been seen, even if it's been there all along. Some of you may remember that years ago, I was one of those who gave leadership to the New Wineskins Association of Churches. In essence, what we were doing is trying to offer a new paradigm of how to be a church back to an institution that didn't want to hear it. And you know what I learned during that time? Whenever you propose a paradigm shift of the church, it's perceived by the power people as a threat. Well, I'm proposing that we consider a paradigm shift of what it means to be church and what it means to be Christian. Let's put up the next slide, please. Whether we intend to or not, when all of us say church, I'm going to church. What church do you go to? Do you want to come to my church? Most of us have a cognitive confirmation bias of seeing the building. Now, we know that the church isn't the building, right? We knew from when we were kids, open the doors and see all the people, right? We've known that since we were kids. And yet, we only ever see the old woman. We don't see the young woman. It's been there all along, but our confirmation bias is toward institution. What if we had a paradigm shift? What if when we first said the word church, these are the images that came up in our minds? What if it was an image of a multi-ethnic, multi-generational, multi-talented, multi-gifted people all moving together in the same kingdom direction? That, my friends, would be called a movement. Go back to the EPC's vision statement. I'm not making this up. The EPC, as a family of churches, is called to be a global movement. I'm just telling you what missiologists tell us what a movement is, and I'm calling us to get in alignment with what God is doing, not only biblically and historically, but presently in other parts of the world. It's really hard to view church and ourselves differently, but we are going to need a paradigm shift if we're to be more biblically faithful church, a movement of disciples who make disciples. Okay, the last barrier or obstacle for us is our present reality. So allow me to dig into some data, if you could. So data nerds, here we go. 2018 Lifeway study, 60% of Protestant churches in the U.S. have plateaued or were declining, and that's before COVID. Bob Stauffer, you want to say amen? Pew Research study from 2007 to 2014 shows an 8% decline of the number of adults in the U.S. who claim to be Christian. Barna Research reveals that only 4% of unchurched people who have been invited by a friend to attend a worship service at their congregation actually went. 23% of those who identified themselves as not being Christians declined. But get this, 73% were never invited at all. Let's take a look at the EPC for a second. We just got our annual church reports in. And thank you, by the way, for doing that. I loved it when I was at the Presbyterian of the Pacific Southwest. They had people running around the room with t-shirts that said, "Minutes matter, minutes matter." I know as Presbyterians, you know, we think some of those things are silly, but they really do make a difference. We had like a 96% return rate on our ACRs this year, and that gives us real data that we can track and know if we're being effective in what we're doing. Let me give you some of that, okay? Here's some good news. Our membership actually rose 1% in 2021 to 2022, coming out of COVID. Not a lot, but coming out of COVID, I'll take it. Total worship attendance during that same period of time is down 1.4%. But get this, in-person worship has grown by 19.2% coming out of the pandemic, and it's virtual worship that's taken the hit. It is now down 25.2%. The number of our congregations in the EPC is down 0.5%. We have roughly 630-ish congregations and church plants. Okay, would you like some good news? Ready for this. About a year and a half ago, we doubled down because gospel priorities aren't really priorities unless you put money behind them. Up until the time you assign people and money to priorities, they're only aspirations. So we doubled down on church health that was sorely under-resourced. This last year, between 2021 and 2022, we had 675 adult baptisms in the EPC. Now, to give you a little bit of perspective, going back about 5 years ago, we had about 3. Want to hear some better news? We had 1,613 infant baptisms this year. Ah, here's my favorite news. Ready for this one? We had 2,870 first-time professions of faith. So I'm going to keep saying it until those numbers go up even more. We're going to put the E back in the EPC. And the way we do that is by disciples who make disciples who make disciples. So we have opportunities, my friends. The gospel priorities that we are witnessing as we travel to our presbyteries are growing. They're collaborating. Presbyteries are organizing their mission around those things. They're resourcing congregations. The Office of the General Assembly exists to serve you so that you can help carry out the Great Commission. That's why we exist. Whatever money you send up, we send back down. We exist to serve you. There is an apostolic, yes, small a, apostolic opportunity before us with the movement of peoples, the proliferation of gospel resources, and a new spiritual openness among Generation Z that has been recently seen in things such as the Holy Spirit's renewing work on, say, the campuses all across our country, like the one at Asbury University. Is it possible that we are coming into a kind of kairos moment to have eyes of see how the Lord is moving around the world and how it comes to our doorsteps and how people are being sent to us and we are being sent out, because in our very DNA is that we are the sent ones. We are disciples who make disciples who make disciples who make disciples. We are called to be a movement of disciple makers. What does it mean to be an effective biblical leader? Michael Davis and his team, his effective biblical leadership team, explored this more thoroughly yesterday. And I absolutely love all the definitions that they're coming up with. Here's a good definition. An effective biblical leader, they're deciding, has been defined by our EBL team as people of increasingly Christ-like character whose example and passion inspires, and I would add invites, others to follow Christ. A disciple has similarly been defined by Damian Gerke, the author of book In the Way, The Church as We Know It Can Be a Discipleship Movement Again. Discipleship is defined by Gerke this way: someone who follows or imitates Christ with their whole life, having learned it from another disciple. I love that definition. I love it. And another one: someone who loves Jesus, who lives as Jesus lived, deliberately and faithfully practicing his teachings and way of life. That's actually Gerke. Okay, a couple of possible outcomes here. Let's consider two more definitions before we close up and ask a few rabbinic questions at the very end. Multiplication. What is multiplication if it is to be one of our four gospel priorities? It is church planting. But did you know that like two of our four gospel priorities basically are church planting? Church planting is church planting, but world outreach's primary way of bringing the gospel to the ends of the earth is, what do you call it, whole life, whole cycle? Whole cycle, church planting. So two of our four are basically church planting. Why? Because that's where rapid multiplication actually occurs, right? So, according to missiologist Damian Gerke, multiplication is the, quote, the result of a persistent, prioritized strategy to make disciples that can make disciples. So when we speak of multiplication in the EPC as one of our priorities, and we're typically referring to church planting, and that's right, it is much more than that. Two of our four priorities, church planting, domestic, world outreach, international, marshal our resources after getting after the Great Commission. And it's our desire that every congregation in the EPC would be involved in going after the Great Commission in their Jerusalem, their Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Okay, let's talk about movement a little bit. If we're to be a multiplication movement, a definition. According to the 2414 network or coalition, a movement is an intentional, organized network of discipleship relationships that has reached multiple generations. Let me say that again. A movement, because remember, we're supposed to be a global movement. Movement is an intentional, organized network of discipleship relationships. What if that's the way people describe the EPC? What if they said, well, they're a pretty, you know, intentional, organized network of discipleship relationships trying to reach multiple generations for Jesus? I'd take that definition. There's a lot to unpack here, but I'd like you to just focus on the very last thing that's there: multiple generations. And just a little hint, we're going to pick that theme up next year when we get to Memphis at Hope Church, and we talk about from generation to generation. That's a little bit of where we're going. Okay, I'm going to round this out with some rabbinic questions. What if this chaotic time is also God's opportunity time? What if the church actually looked and acted more biblically? What if we really loved God and neighbor the way Jesus did and taught us to do? What if every EPC congregation was a missionary society? What if every believer was actually a disciple, gathered to be with him, sent to be like him? And what if the EPC really, truly was committed to carrying out the Great Commission? What if the EPC was a multiplying movement of disciples who make disciples? I think we would be effective biblical leaders, thriving in healthy congregations who are part of a global multiplication movement. And we would simply be disciples who make disciples who make disciples. This quote from Gerke is my last. This is it. Gerke says this: multiplication drives disciple-making movements. Multiplication drives discipleship-making movements. Without multiplication, it's impossible to create and sustain a movement. Multiplication is the key to accomplishing the Great Commission. Reaching large number of individuals, families, groups, subcultures, and eventually entire communities, regions, and ethnic groups. It infuses and contextualizes the gospel into a group's culture, ultimately transforming it from the inside out as significant numbers of people in the group come to faith and reorient their lives around being a disciple of Jesus. Does that sound like something you would like to be a part of? Come on, EPC. Rosemary said she wasn't prophetic, but she also told us that Satan would come against us if we took this stuff seriously. And then a tornado hit. Which she says, by the way, was not a surprise to her. Okay, I'll unpack that later. Let me just finish with this text of scripture because I think it gets at this idea of disciples who make disciples who make disciples. I close with this, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. You then, my brothers and sisters, be strengthened by the grace of God that is in Christ Jesus. And what you have heard from me, and in the presence of many witnesses, entrust it to faithful men and women who will be able to teach others also. That sounds an awful lot like a disciple who is making a disciple who are sent out to make disciples. That, my friends, is where we are going in the EPC. And no tornado is going to stop that. So would you pray with me? Lord, we commit this to you. And if it's of you, we know that nothing could stop it. But if it's somehow clever words that we've conjured up, then we know that it won't prosper. So we pray that you would go before us in all things, that your prevenient grace would go before us in all things, that, Lord, we might tell others what has been told to us, that as your disciples, that we would join the movement of your Spirit biblically and historically and across the globe even today, that we would be part of that movement. Pour out your Spirit on your church, because your mission has a church and you have called us to be your disciples. Lord, we will give you everything we've got. Our whole life, it is yours. This family of churches is yours. If you would be so pleased, Lord, to multiply us, that we might be disciples who make disciples, who go from this place and don't go through any amnesia doors, but we go through this place to make disciples. Even now, as we make our way down to the sanctuary to worship, you gather us to be with you. But when that worship is done, the mission begins, and we're sent out to be like you as your disciples. In Jesus' name, all of God's people in agreement together said, amen. Amen and amen. Worship is down the hall in the sanctuary in about 20 minutes. We'll see you down there.